नमस्ते सर, आई एम रियली सो एक्साइटेड टू हैव यू हियर। यू नो, आफ्टर वॉचिंग योर
ओके
सेक्शंस इन एबीपी न्यूज लाइव एंड इन वेरियस अदर चैनल्स, आई एम रियली मोर देन प्रिविलेज्ड एज आई एम लुकिंग एट अ सेलिब्रिटी राइट नेक्स्ट टू मी बाय द साइड। आई एम सो
नॉट
हैप्पी
एट
टू
ऑल
हैव
नॉट
यू हियर।
एट नॉट एट ऑल वी आर जस्ट स्मॉल टाइम जर्नलिस्ट एंड जस्ट दैट इलेक्शंस आर अराउंड द कॉर्नर एंड वी हैव स्पेंट सम टाइम इन चेन्नई वॉचिंग देम सो वी विल ट्राई टू डिकोड इट एज टू द बेस्ट ऑफ माई एबिलिटी एंड आई एम नॉट अ सूथसेयर नॉर अ सेफोलॉजिस्ट आई एम जस्ट अ जर्नलिस्ट सो आई विल ट्राई टू टेल द स्टोरी एज इट इज दैट आई सी what I understand in the hope that it will make it clearer to the viewers what's happening and what's likely to happen.
Yeah, so sir, I am jumping on to my questions. So first of
Please.
all, M.K. Stalin versus Edappadi Palaniswamy. As you are someone who has understood Tamil Nadu politics in and out, in your opinion, who has an edge?
As things stand now, going by the recent electoral history, the fact that M.K. Stalin swept along with Congress the 2019 general election, barring just one seat, they mopped up all the other 38 seats, and together with allies from the left and the smaller parties, they scored they got a vote bank vote percentage of over 50%. Of course, local elections are different than national elections. Issues are different, personalities are different. In fact, here we are choosing a chief minister, there it was for a prime minister. But still, in the face of a huge Modi wave across the nation, it was M.K. Stalin, of course, largely, although many people blame the Congress for everything, but it was a vote for the Congress also that out of the 9 seats given to the Congress, they won 8, I think. And DMK won the rest of the seats from Tamil Nadu. So if they maintain that momentum, that alliance is intact. From the DMK side, there is no change in the alliance. Maybe there have been a few additions. There are no subtractions as of now. So their alliance is pakka. And it has had some 1.5 years already in the making. And it's going to benefit a little from the 10 years of anti-incumbency. I would not like to believe that, you know, there is a vacuum, political vacuum and all, with the demise of the two stalwarts who were sworn enemies of one another, Jayalalitha and Karunanidhi, because Edappadi has filled in that vacuum and M.K. Stalin has filled in the other vacuum from the DMK side. And in both of these Dravidian parties, the DMK was better prepared for any eventuality in that they had a clear succession plan. Whereas in AIADMK, there was infighting going on. But at the moment, as things stand on paper, as well as on form, DMK is slightly ahead, as you mentioned a few surveys, which put up about 4 or 5% lead, which is there, and it is with that kind of a momentum and advantage that DMK poses a big challenge as of now, unless, you know, something happens and campaign things change on the ground, and there are some factors that we are not foreseeing at the moment. Things should likely go the DMK way.
Okay, so that's interesting. Sir, my next question is, Kamala Hassan is a factor. You know, it was evident that Kamala Hassan could garner 5% of the vote, of the entire vote bank. Then this was based on the 2019 general elections, wherein his party MNM won 5 to 6% approximately. But now he has been campaigning widely for the past few months. And also, we are hearing that he is garnering more support from women. Many women are gathering around to see him, number one. And number two, we see Sarath Kumar, who has been an ADMK alliance till now, and he reached out to Kamala Hassan to form an alliance. And then IJK, the founder of SRM University, Mr. Pachamuthu, so who founded IJK, he was with DMK last time and he managed to win a seat as well as part of the alliance. And now he has also moved out and he joined with Kamala Hassan. And if rumors are to be believed, more such smaller parties are going to join Kamala Hassan. So you really think Kamala Hassan stands a chance to make a difference this time as a third front force?
Well, Tamil Nadu will continue to be a two-horse race with Kamala Hassan trying to make his presence felt and maybe look at a future. I mean, he's not obviously going in for a win this time. He's going to try and establish himself as a force. Yes, in closely fought assembly elections, a third front may upset either DMK or AIDMK. And he will hit both the parties, but whom he's going to hit more, it is very difficult to predict as of now. But going by his stature, his statements, and he is likely to attract the floating voters who are not yet committed. And also that also the, from the elite classes, as well as the Brahmin class, a little bit, which is pro BJP largely. So I don't see him making a huge impact. Maybe he could win a seat odd here or there, possibly his own seat if he's lucky. But he's only going to be a vote cutter, but whom he's going to damage more is very difficult to say as of now. But AIDMK should be more worried about him as of now.
So, sir, another question, again, on a possible third front. You know, Owaisi has been telling that after the Bihar elections, he has been telling that we will contest in West Bengal and Tamil Nadu as well, right? And in West Bengal, we've seen that there are rumors that he might be joining the secular front along with Congress and left. And again, as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, the two existing Muslim parties, one is Manidhaneya Makkal Katchi and we have IUML along with DMK, and their seat sharing deal is already sealed up, right? Yeah. And so when Stalin reached out to Owaisi, these two parties went vehemently against that. So they've been criticizing Stalin and they've been criticizing Owaisi together. So, and also Owaisi since then has been telling that we identified, I won't say like he said that, but rather there's been like rumors and speculations
speculation
in the market that maybe like there are 40 seats with more than 1 lakh Muslim population in Tamil Nadu where Owaisi could possibly come and contest, right? And also, here again, there is a question of language. You know, Muslims in Tamil Nadu are more inclined towards Tamil language. You know, so we really cannot say that even though people would have taken him as an ideal person to follow, not essentially they are going to listen to him speaking in Hindi, right? So they may not like it as well, and they may not find the connect as well. So what do you say? If at all Owaisi is going to today come and announce that I'm contesting in these number of seats, will he make a difference or will he be a mere vote cutter for DMK?
He may not be able to win at all just like he did in Bihar. Bihar was an entirely different game. And the you rightly pointed out, the Tamil Nadu Muslim doesn't identify himself with OIC or anybody. Rather, they would be identifying themselves either with AIDMK or DMK, but more towards DMK because of the secular credentials and the very fact that AIDMK has gone tied up with BJP is a reason enough for him to be a little wary of AIDMK. And also, it must be, I mean, Tamil Nadu voter is an educated voter and he's smart and he knows what's happening around. There have been assessments to the fact that OIC was indirectly helping the BJP. Yeah. By cutting into secular votes, I mean, he's got every right to. I mean, nobody's criticizing him for that. But the fact that he contested, and in close contest, he made a few people from the Janata Dal United and Congress to lose, eventually helping the formation that formed the government, which has BJP component in it, in Bihar. So in closely fought elections where victory margins are very narrow, if he takes away, say, 500 votes, maybe he can cook the goose of whichever candidate. To that extent, yes. But as a political impact, he doesn't have much in Tamil Nadu, although he's from a neighboring state.
Yes.
We must remember in the 2016 assembly elections, if I may take a little bit of time, take you back a little bit, there were at least 13 constituencies where the victory margin was less than 1,000.
Yes.
Very narrow. And if, say, between 1,000 and 5,000, there will be another 20-30, which means very, very narrowly fought. So that is where a Kamala Hassan or an OIC may pose a little bit of risk, but it's all, I'm sure all these big Dravidian parties must be factoring in all of these elements when they go out and make their strategies. Jayalalitha did was she managed to split the vote against her in five different directions.
Yes.
Where left was with her in 2011, she kicked them out.
Yes.
Captain Vijayakant, we forgot all about him, but this time he's going around with BJP.
No, I have BJP a question left, about him in the coming section.
Yeah. Okay. So anyway, it was the strategy of Amma that ensured her victory rather than her popularity, I mean, which was constant anyway. Her vote bank was intact and she added on to it through her welfare measures and women-centric programs, etc. But at the same time, if you look at the victory margin, it was very, very narrow. The numbers may be huge, like 20-30 difference between the winner and loser, but the vote percentage was less than 2%, the victory margin. So yeah. BJP had nearly won. It was because its alliance did not, it wasn't proper alliance. If DMDK, if Captain Vijayakant, if Stalin had not been very tough stance at that time and he somehow managed to pull him along, that 5% he would have brought.
Yes.
So probably he erred there. And this time, luckily for Stalin, I'm not speaking for A, B or C, but from Stalin's perspective, he has managed to drive a hard bargain with the Congress and reduce 15 seats he had given the last time. And Congress can only damage in only 25 seats, not 41 like that last time. Congress is, a weak link in the entire DMK alliance as of now. But yes, Rahul Gandhi has been making waves literally. I mean, to the extent that BJP is complaining that he should not jump in the sea, he should not campaign here, he should not do this, which means Rahul Gandhi is making an impact, if not among the voters, at least among BJP.
That's interesting. And sir, yeah, as I said, my next question is on DMDK and Captain Vijayakant. Yeah. So in 2006, Vijayakant was the X factor, you know. Despite, I must really say, the pre-polls were favoring Jayalalitha in 2006. So whatever pre-polls were taken, it all said that there will be a comfortable victory for Jayalalitha. And then going forward slowly, it started fading up. You know, and after, in the mid of the campaign trails, suddenly a trend started emerging that DMK is getting the edge. You know, that's all because of thanks to the color TV schemes and 1 kg rice for 1 rupees and all those schemes.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it all really won DMK a good set. You know, and also they had a very formidable alliance. They had Communist and Congress together, and they had other smaller parties together. And that all gained them. But on the other hand, Jayalalitha, even though she didn't have a very big alliance, it was ADMK, MDMK, and VCK that time. You know, still they managed to win 69 seats. And also the vote share was comparatively not so high between the two, right? And also Jayalalitha and also again, as you said, that split in votes and the smaller margins which gave an edge to DMK was because of DMDK mostly.
Yeah.
In all those places, DMDK split the votes which Jayalalitha was to get. And again, exactly. In 2011, Jayalalitha got very clever and she thought, okay, DMDK has to be with me. And she brought him in the alliance and together they won big.
See, it was in 2011, I distinctly remember, Show Ramaswamy, yes. He was very close to Jayalalitha and it is said that he used to advise Jayalalitha also.
Yes.
And the day Vijayakanth came and signed up with Jayalalitha, he said, now she is sweeping. See, that is the importance of Vijayakanth. And it is so interesting to notice that with the same Vijayakanth on his side was victorious for her. And by also kicking him out also, Jayalalitha ensured her own victory. When she ensured that he doesn't go to the DMK.
Yes.
I don't know whether she ensured or it happened in whichever, but it kind of fitted in with the Jayalalitha strategy of splitting votes against her in different directions. So something like in the neighboring state, Y.S. Rajshekhar Reddy did with Chiranjeevi.
Yes.
Chiranjeevi is like Rajinikanth of Andhra Pradesh. And why I'm telling you this, I'm taking you to Andhra Pradesh is because it has significance and relevance to Tamil Nadu also.
Yes.
Chiranjeevi was supposed to be a mega star who it was seen would do an NTR. Whereas he was given the role and script was written by YSR. He was to abuse YSR more than Chandrababu Naidu so that he split the anti-YSR vote. And it is because of that YSR won the elections and an election that he should have lost. So probably it could be one of the reasons, adding to the health reasons, that Rajinikanth may have decided not to take the plunge after. Even despite the presence of all the film stars and all, I think their days are over in politics. Like in the olden days, it is Tamil Nadu continues to be a race between two regional Tamil Nadu parties. And it will continue to be so till one of the national parties actually gains enough strength and dethrones either of them. Either the AIDMK or DMK. But it is not happening in this election. If BJP gains sufficient ground this time, so it will be the AIDMK that has to worry about its future, because DMK would have gone by anyway.
Yeah.
If Stalin doesn't win this election, it may be very difficult for him to retain his spoke and continue and maintain the party like he is doing.
Absolutely. So, as we all know, Western Tamil Nadu is a stronghold of ADMK. And BJP as well has a footing in Coimbatore and nearby regions. To some extent.
Nearby areas.
Yeah.
And Kanyakumari.
Yes, yes, exactly. And so now, based on some of the recent opinion polls taken, and these opinion polls were very common, and these were more of an opinion given by a journalist way back in September 2020. Yeah, so he was telling that maybe we are ready to vote for it. People were telling that we are ready to vote for ADMK if BJP leaves the alliance. So is BJP being present in the alliance affecting ADMK's prospects to win?
It may be a reason, because Edappadi Palaniswamy, by his own, has given a good account of himself, contrary to public perception that he was just a stopgap arrangement. He would fall any time. But he managed to hold on to power, the chief minister's position, as well as he took control over the party, which was not expected of him. I mean, initially, they were all seen as stooges of Chinnamma also at one stage.
Yeah.
And on the governance front, I think he did a reasonably good job. And in fact, to combat COVID, the way he brought in Mr. Radhakrishnan,
yes,
the former health secretary, I think that was a very good decision he made. And I think Tamil Nadu has got a grip on COVID now.
Yeah.
Things are slowly getting back to normal. So, and Tamil Nadu bureaucracy is anyway, it works on autopilot. But still, Edappadi has done enough to negate any anti-incumbency on that front. Plus, he's got the old Jayalalitha's women voter thing going for him. But the trouble with an alliance with BJP is the image of BJP as a Hindi party, a party that is trying to dictate terms to Tamil Nadu, a party that is seen as anti-Tamil Nadu in quotes, inverted quotes, because on its stand on various issues, like NEET is one example where a couple of students committed suicide also. Tamil Nadu was not in favor of joining, as long as Mrs. Jayalalitha was alive,
yeah,
the central government didn't dare to do anything. But the moment she went away, it started exerting pressure and getting the government to do what it wants. So there is an impression among the people, right or wrong, I don't know, that it's a Hindi party, it is trying to dominate, only DMK can stand up to it. I mean, that sort of a impression is building, which of course DMK will be behind any such campaign, and it may be behind such Vishwa campaign also, we don't know. But yes, that is one issue that ADMK will have to think about how it will overcome that. It does explain that, you know, the state government has to be very friendly with the central government in the overall interest of Tamil Nadu, and it can show the various projects that have been announced by the Prime Minister recently. The central government is favorable towards Tamil Nadu, they can say, they can cite the recent budget allocations.
Yes.
But yes, voters are not fools. They are seeing why only now and why not before. Plus the language thing you had mentioned earlier, just by speaking one or two odd words in Tamil and rest of the year trying to force Hindi through some means or the other, maybe intentionally or unintentionally, I don't know, but Hindi is a very emotive language, emotive issue. Even now, although it may not be visible to everybody outside like it used to be in earlier days, but yes, it still is an issue. It is. It feeds on the apprehensions of the Tamil people that Hindi will be forced on us, and if Hindi comes, we will be at a disadvantage. And there are instances people cite that many third and class 3 and class 4 employment also, their local Tamilians are losing out in competition to people from outside. I mean, these are all, I don't know whether it's the truth or it's canard being spread, but yes, language and its economic impact, its impact on livelihood, its impact on, generally by lording over somebody, just because of the language, it is always an emotional issue. So I wonder whether the other aspects of the BJP, its strong leadership, it's being in power in center, if the Tamil Nadu voter weighs in his cost-benefit analysis, if he forgives the BJP and accepts it, then cool. Otherwise, yes, you are right in your surmise that it may be an issue that AIDMK is saddled with some amount of difficult situation because of this alliance.
Yeah. And, sir, my next question is on the recent announcement made by Narendra Modi. And I initially called it a masterstroke because, you know, the entire sentiment turned towards ADMK and BJP to some extent. That is when Modi, in an event in Chennai, he announced about the Devendra Kulavelalar community. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that the bill is passed and now you people get what you want. You know, once he said that, I have personally seen down south in Tamil Nadu, many people have started worshipping him for that. You know, they said that we earlier told this to many people, nobody listened to us. And then like this guy suddenly comes up and he has just made it. In just a stroke. And you know, that is one aspect. And the second aspect is the 1 year quota, which was announced by Edappadi Palaniswamy, that is hours before the election commission announced the date of the election. You know, that is 10.7%. In fact, that was not at all expected because, you know, it was like PMK was fighting for it for the past 3 months.
That was one of the conditions of PMK to join the alliance.
Okay.
And by virtue of having the ruling party on your side from both state and center, it has already extracted its price. Naturally, see, any kind of concession will always motivate people.
But is it going to convert into...
The central government and the state government, both governments are powerful enough and smart enough to give people what they want, especially on the eve of elections. So that advantage will always be there. And yes, Modi, despite what all you have these trending on Twitter that go back Modi and he... not being a very popular figure as compared to Rahul Gandhi, who enjoys greater popularity than Prime Minister Modi in Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Even in last general elections, it was this scenario and nothing much has changed. So that will be there. There will be some positive impact of these decisions, I'm surely. But will they be enough? Will they be strong enough to carry the AIDMK over the cross line? I mean, the BJP, AIDMK, DMDK, PMK alliance has a lot of work to do. And also it needs to be seen whether the alliance chemistry works on the ground, whether the vote transfers take place easily. At least in Congress and DMK case, while the Congress votes get transferred 100% nearly, it's the DMK vote, they don't get transferred so easily. So that is why the Congress strike rate is poor. I mean, poor people, they keep losing, but the entire blame cannot be laid at the Congress door in an election in Tamil Nadu.
Simply. So, sir, one last question. So, of course, you already given the outlook of who has the edge, DMK or ADMK. But again, like, I am more concerned about BJP now. So BJP, even though like in 96, they managed to win one seat, that is in Kanyakumari district, Padmanabhapuram, And in 2001, they managed to win 4 seats with DMK in the alliance. But, you know, in the coming years, and largely their vote share has remained 2 to 3% only. It hasn't grown, it hasn't gone down also, but it has remained 2 to 3% only. So, but this time, all the entire machinery of BJP is focused on Tamil Nadu. In fact, on all the states, I must say, like with GHMC polls,
they focus. That's what I was coming to. They even municipal polls also. They take every election seriously. So this time also, and because there are fewer states, they can concentrate on Tamil Nadu also. Their main focus, it seems to me, it is West Bengal. Yes. But Tamil Nadu also, their focus is very much, it's under their radar.
So, will that convert into votes and seats possibly?
It is very difficult to say. But they will open their account, surely. Last time also, they were expected to do well in the Coimbatore and that region, but eventually they lost out. But at that time, they were not in an alliance with AIDMK. So the alliance with AIDMK will surely help BJP. There's no doubt about it. Whether BJP's presence will greatly help AIDMK or not remains to be seen.
Okay. So, sir, despite all your busy schedule, you've given time for this and you've given good set of insights for us to ponder upon. You know, we would like to have more conversations with you in the coming days. And I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, it was a nice pleasure to be with you. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.